Good afternoon. In today's class, we will be seeing the switching techniques concept continuation. So in the previous class, I have shared that switching is basically a technique to decide the best route. So to decide best route for transmission from multiple routes, switching technique is used. And based on this, we have seen the different types or classification of switching techniques. So I said, in according to the syllabus, we will be studying circuit switching and packet switching. There is one more switching technique, which is message switching, which we won't be studying. In packet switching, again, we will have the two kind of approaches. One is the datagram approach, and the other is the virtual circuit approach. So these are the different classification of switching. Now we will proceed. In yesterday's class, we have seen circuit switching already. So in today's class, we will be proceeding with the packet switching and the two types of approach, that is datagram and virtual circuit approach. So let's continue with the lesson on packet switching. So when yesterday we talked about circuit switching, we understood that the telecommunication network was originally designed to handle the voice traffic. So earlier, before the advent of mobile phones and internet in handheld devices, we had the telecommunication network with only voice. So for that reason, for only voice, we had the circuit switching concept. That is, the circuit switching characteristic is that whenever we are creating a link between two stations, then a channel is dedicated to a particular call. So for voice connections, the resulting circuit will enjoy a high percentage of utilization. And however, the circuit switching network started being used for data, then there were two disadvantages of circuit switching. So now we are studying the disadvantages of circuit switching, why we cannot use it for data. Circuit switching is not really good for data. So in that case, the first disadvantage is, in a typical host data connection, that is if you are using a personal computer logged on a database server, then if we have created a dedicated line, then the line will be idle. So with the data connections, a circuit switching. So in the case of, suppose if you are sending data, we might send some, if you are sending images, you may send one image, then you may wait for 5 minutes and then send another image. So in that case, that dedicated line is idle. Okay. If you're talking on phone, this line will be continuously busy, right? But if a person A is connected to person B using a voice call, then they will be continuously talking and that line will be busy. But suppose in the same case, the person A is sending an image to person B, then he may send an image today, then he may send an image tomorrow. In that case, if you create a dedicated line, it will remain idle or it will not be used completely, efficiently. So in that case, circuit switching was not really at an advantage. It became inefficient. Also, the second advantage is, in a circuit switching network, the connection provides for transmission at a constant data rate. So if you know, if you're talking on voice or if you're talking on a call, then basically whenever we are talking, the data rate should be constant. That is, the speed at which we are talking will remain the same throughout. It is not like we will be sending the voice first at a natural or a normal volume, a normal speed, and then your speed the way you're talking. So that will become, the speed will become less or more. That won't happen. But in the case of data, when you're sending data, then suppose if you're sending a video, then you require the speed to be high. If you're sending an image, the speed can remain normal. So basically, whenever you're transmitting the data, the two devices connected must transmit and receive at the same data rate. If you're transmitting a video, we have studied it in the earlier protocol and the synchronization techniques, actually, that if the sender is sending the data at some data rate, then the receiver must also receive the data at the same data rate. So for this reason, the circuit switching was not a good, was not really useful for sending the data. So now to understand, to overcome these disadvantages, the packet switching operation or packet switching was started. And what is a packet switching operation? Basically, whenever we are talking about packet switching, it transmits the data. So let's write packet switching. So it transmits the data across digital networks by breaking it down into blocks or packets for more efficient transfer. So whenever we are talking about packet switching, it will transmit the data in the form of packets. And each time one device sends a file to another, if we are sending a file, the file is broken down into different packets. Or basically small, the file is broken down into small files, multiple files, so that it can determine the most efficient route for sending the data. Why are we breaking it down? To find out an efficient route. To find efficient route. And the network devices can then route the packets to the destination where the receiving devices reassemble them for use. So now the sender is dividing the file into multiple packets, and the receiver, what it should do, the receiver must assemble these packets to make it in the same way the sender had it in earlier. So basically, whenever we are talking about packets, they, as we said in the earlier unit, that is, the if we are breaking down a file into packets, then we will have a sequence number to make sure that the order is maintained when the receiver receives it and reassembles it. So this is the introduction to packet switching. Now, what is packet switching? Basically, it is the transfer of small pieces of data across various networks. So packet switching can be said as, the definition, we can define it as transfer of small pieces of data across various networks. This data is often called as packets. And why do we need to do this? To allow for faster, more efficient data transfer. Often, whenever we are talking about packets, whenever a user sends a file across a network, it gets transferred in smaller data packets and not in one piece. So for example, if you are sending a 30 MB file, it will be divided into packets, and packet will have then a packet header. Now, what will that packet header have? It will have the IP address of the sender, IP address of both the sender and the receiver, and the number of packets, total number of packets of that particular file. And also, we need to have the most important thing, if we need to assemble it later, then that will be the sequence number. So this is the packet header. Whenever we are talking about the network layer will take the data from the transport layer, attach a header to it, and form it as a packet, and then give it to the data link layer. So now let's just see the slide. So circuit switching was earlier designed for voice. Why was it designed for voice? These are the two things. Resource is dedicated to a particular pulse. So whenever that resource or that line is dedicated, then much of the time of a data connection is idle and the data rate is fixed. So both ends must operate at the same rate. Now, what is the basic operation of the packet switching? So data is transmitted in the form of small packets or short packets. Typically, it is around 100 octets, or we can even call it as bytes. longer messages are split into a series of packets, and each packet contains a portion of user data plus some control info. What is that control info? That is the packet header. So that header will have the routing address info, and it will also have the source address, destination address, etc. So basically, the control information includes the information that the network requires to be able to route the packet through the network and deliver it to the intended destination. Packets are received at the nodes, stored briefly, that is buffered, and passed on to the next node. So it is passed on to the next node. So this technique of storing and then passing on is known as the store and forward technique. So now let's see the diagram to understand this. So whenever we have the, assume that this figure depicts a simple packet switching network, then consider a packet to be sent from a station A to the station E. Okay, then we are returning to this figure, the original figure. Let me show that. In this figure, suppose if I am sending the packet from the station A to station E, then first and foremost, what will happen? The packet will have control information that will show the IP address of the station E. Then the packet is sent from the station A to the node 4, and then node 4 stores the packet, determines or thinks about which node should it send to. Should it send to node 5 or should it send to node 7? Suppose if it is going to node 5, then what will happen? It will queue the packet, or the packet will be waiting in line to go out on that link. Whenever that link is available, the packet is transmitted to the node 5. Now again, which will forward the packet to node 6? So here it won't think, because there is only one route, it won't think, it will just simply forward the packet to node 6, and then it is finally reached to the station E. So why is this better over circuit switching? So if you remember the concept of circuit switching with the same diagram yesterday, I said that first and foremost, the connection is established. So once the packet is en route, it won't think about the connection. First, it will check the connection. So if we are traveling from A to E, then in the case of circuit switching, it will first create a connection, then only it will start the transfer. But if you notice, with the case of packet switching, it is sending the packet, and the packet, when it is en route, then only it will think about which route to be taken. Now, what is the advantage over the circuit switching? Let's see that. So first and foremost, the link line efficiency is greater. Line efficiency is greater. Why is that? Because there is no wait time, and a single node-to-node link can be dynamically shared by many packets over time. So here, if single line is not dedicated to a transmission, here multiple packets can be sent from either station A, station B. Once station A sends a packet, station B can also send its own packet, because the line is not dedicated, or line is not given to one transmission only. And the packets are queued up basically. In this case, the line here, if there is another packet already being transmitted, then the packets are put in line, or they are waiting in a queue. And the transmission is done once the queue starts moving. So, but if you remember with circuit switching, a node to node link is already allocated, and once it is allocated, no other station can use it for its own transmission. So much of the time, that link may remain idle. For that reason, packet switching is efficient for sending the data, and circuit switching is efficient for being used for voice. And if packet switching network can perform data rate conversion. So the second point is PS. Whenever I'm writing PS, it means packet switching. It can perform data rate conversion. Now, what is this data rate conversion? This means that basically, when two stations of different data rates, different transmission rates, are exchanging packet, because each connects its node to a proper data rate. Okay, now this is the packet switching advantage. In the case of circuit switching, it should be, that is, the switching capacity must be the same in both the sender and the receiver's case. Now after that, we have the next. Whenever traffic becomes heavy on the circuit switching network, some calls are blocked. So that is, in the case of circuit switching, network refuses to accept additional requests if the load increases. So basically, in circuit switching, if load increases or the amount of data increases, the calls are blocked. Since we are talking about voice calls over here, so I'm simply writing calls. Calls are blocked. Now, what will happen in the case of packet switching? Packet switching, the data is never blocked, or that is basically packets, even if the load increases, packets are accepted, but there might be some delay. Some delay might occur in the case of packet switching, but at least the packets are accepted. Here, the packets or the data are completely blocked. After that, finally, the final point of this advantage is this: priorities can be used. So if a node has a number of packets ready for transmission, it can transmit the highest priority packet first. So in the case of packet switching, highest priority packet is transferred first. And these packets will therefore experience less delay. In the case of, if you remember circuit switching, there cannot be any highest priority, because once a connection is established, the data will be continuous. The data will be continuously transmitted. So now, in the, as I mentioned already, packet switching, we have two types of packet switching, and I have been talking about the virtual circuit approach. So there are two approaches basically whenever we are talking about packet switching. First is the virtual circuit, then the other is the datagram approach. Now, what does this mean? The datagram approach is basically the connection-less approach. This is very, very important. These approaches are important. And what is the virtual circuit approach? The virtual circuit approach is the connection-oriented packet switching. Connection-oriented, that is, in the case of virtual circuit, we will have a connection. In the case of datagram, it is connection-less. Now, what does this mean? So let's just see it briefly, then we can continue. So basically, whenever we are talking about virtual circuit or connection-oriented, so in the connection-oriented packet switching, data packets are first assembled and then numbered. So here, in this case, first, all the data packets are collected. And we give the sequence number. Sequence number is given. Then they travel across a predefined route. Travel across a predefined route. Sequentially. So in the same sequence, they will travel. Sequentially, the travel will occur. And address information is not needed because all the packets are sent in the sequence. Okay. So in the case of what is now datagram or connection-less packet switching, so this means each packet is individually sent. There is no, it is not sent in sequence, but it is in each packet is sent individually. This means each packet contains complete routing information. So here, in the case of the virtual circuit, each packet did not need the address because they are going in a sequence one after the other. But in the case of datagram, each packet will have the complete information because they are traveling individually. Suppose if you are going together as a family, then each person need not have the address of the destination. But if you're traveling, each person is traveling individually from different routes, then each person needs to have the address of wherever you're going. So that can be taken as a real life example. So, but it also means that the packets are traveling. So in the case of datagram, packets are traveling through different paths of transmission, and out of delivery is possible. That is, they may not arrive in sequence. So that is why it is known as the datagram switching. And each packet in this case will have the source address, destination address, and the total number of packets and the sequence for reassembly. So once the packets reach their destination through different routes, the receiving devices rearranges them to form the original message. So this is in the case of connection less packet switching, that is the datagram approach. In the case of virtual circuit approach, first all the packets are collected, then the sequence number is given, and then they travel in sequence. So packet number one will go first, then packet number two, and in this way they will keep on traveling on in the same sequence. So over here, each packet does not need its own address, and it does not need the total number of packets in this way. So now we will see each of them in detail along with how they will be traveling on a specified destination, on a specified route to the given destination. Now, if you notice this diagram, here we have the application data, which is divided into different packets, and the packets will have the control information, which is the packet header, and that packet header is attached to the individual packets and is sent to the packet switching network. Now let's see the advantages. So the first advantage is the line efficiency, that is, single node to node link can be shared by many packets over time. Then we have the data rate conversion. Each station connects to the local node at its own speed. That is, nodes buffer data if required to equalize the rate. So here, whatever station, if it is sending, then at its own speed, it will send the data, and if nodes want to speed it up, they will buffer the data, or if the nodes want to slow it up down according to the receiver, then they may buffer the data to equal the data rate. And packets are accepted even when the network is busy, but in the case of circuit switching, the packets are not accepted, and the delivery may slow down, and priorities can be used. The next is the switching techniques. So the station breaks long messages into packets, and packets sent one at a time to the network. This packets being sent, the approach is basically, whenever you're sending the packets, there are two types of approach. One is the datagram and the other is the virtual circuit approach. So now first we will see the datagram approach. So whenever you're talking about the datagram, each packet is treated independently with no reference to the packet that has already traveled. And packets can take any practical route, while and they may arrive out of order also. So basically, breaking the, here if you see in this diagram, this diagram shows a sequence, time sequence of the progress of three packets to the network. So we have packet number 1, 2, and 3. And this is where the packets are supposed to reach. Then in this way, if you can see, all the packets have started. Here the 3 is on a different, 3 is a bit slow. That is, it is on this first, if I'm just naming the nodes, and this is 1, 2, 3 suppose. Then 3 is traveling from the node 1 to node 2, or the switch 1 to switch 2, and 2 and 1 are traveling from 2 to 3. Now, but in the next diagram, you can just see here, I'll zoom in. So here, 2 and 1 have then separated, and they are traveling on different routes. So basically, each node chooses the next node on the packet's path, taking into account information received from the neighboring nodes. So if the neighboring nodes are saying, okay, I have traffic on my route, then the packets will take different routes. So the packets each with the same destination. So 3, 2, and 1 all are traveling to this station, but they have the same destination address. But what are they doing? They are traveling on different routes. So you can see that 3 is traveling completely on a different route. So first it is here, then it has traveled maybe through this route or any other, and it is going through this node, and 2 and 1 again have taken the same and they are traveling together on this route. After that, they are reaching the destination and the sequence 1, 2, 3. So even sometimes they may arrive out of sequence, and the destination or the receiver might have to reassemble the packets over here. So in the in some datagram networks, it is up to the destination rather than the exit node to do the reordering. So over here in this example, the exit node, that is this last node, is doing the reordering before delivering to the destination. But in some other datagram networks, the destination itself might have to do the reassembling. That is, if the packets arrive out of sequence. So in this case, if you notice, the packet 3 has arrived on this node first, and 2 and 1 are traveling from this node. Over here, the last node before the destination will do the reassembling. So also, it is possible for a packet to be destroyed in the network. For example, if you are talking about packet switching and the node crashes, then all of the packets which are waiting in line to be transferred may be lost. So what will happen then? Now, then it will be either the destination or the last exit node which will have to send the negative acknowledgement and ask the sender to resend the packet. So basically, in this datagram approach, we are studying about the datagram approach, and as I said, datagram approach is a connection-less approach. Okay, so in the case of datagram approach, which is connection-less approach, each packet is treated independently, and the packet here is referred as datagram. So because we are calling the packet as a datagram, that is why we are referring to this approach as a datagram approach. Now we will see the next approach, which is the virtual circuit approach. Now, what is a virtual circuit approach? In the case of virtual circuit approach, a pre-planned route is established before any packets are sent. So once the route is established, all the packets between a pair of communicating stations, what they will do is they follow the same route to the network. And because this route is fixed for the duration of the logical connection, it is kind of similar. So one, because we are already pre-planning the route, it is similar to circuit switching. That is why we are calling it as a virtual circuit approach. So the virtual circuit approach is basically we are pre-planning the route to establish, to create a logical connection. Each packet contains a virtual circuit identifier. Now, what is this virtual circuit identifier? That is, it knows the pre-planned route already. And what it will do is, once it knows the pre-planned route, no routing decisions are required for each packet, and it knows that at any time each station can have more than one virtual circuit to any other station and can have virtual circuits to more than one station. Basically, that is, we can have multiple virtual routes or paths to one station, and we can even have to multiple station different virtual circuits. So what is the main characteristic of the virtual circuit technique? It is basically a route is already planned before the data transfer happens, but that does not mean it is a dedicated path to, you know, which is similar to circuit switching. Okay, so a transmitted packet is buffered at each node and put in line for output over a line. Now, what is the difference between the virtual circuit and the datagram approach? So the difference is basically, in the case of datagram, the route is not planned. Each datagram or each packet can travel through independently. But in the case of the virtual circuit, a routing decision is already made, and once it is made, all the packets are all the packets travel through that route only, in that too in a sequence. Now in the same way, we have the virtual circuit diagram. You can notice over here. So already first from the station to the receiver or the destination, we have a route planned. Now in this case, you will see that 1, 3, 2, 1 will take exactly the same route, and they are reaching the destination over here by using this route. The dotted line over here is the pre-planned route by the virtual circuit. Now what is the comparison if we do with virtual circuit and datagram? So there are a few advantages with virtual circuit. First is that the network may provide services related to virtual circuit, including sequencing and error control. Sequencing is basically, because all the packets follow the same route, they arrive in the original order. And error control is a service that assures not only that the packets arrive in the proper sequence, but also that all the packets arrive correctly. For example, if a packet is in a sequence from node 4 to node 6 and it fails to arrive, then node 6, what node 6 should do is it will request for the retransmission. Now let's see with respect to the advantages and disadvantages to virtual circuits versus datagram. In the case of virtual circuits, network can provide sequencing and also error control. Packets are forwarded more quickly because we don't need any routing decisions, but it is less reliable. Why is it less reliable? Because loss of a node loses all circuits through the node. So if a node is lost, that is, if one of the switch does not work, then in the case of your circuit, all the packets will be, the entire packets will not be received at the destination. Now, what about the datagram approach? The main advantage of datagram approach is it does not need to pre-plan a route. So no call setup phase. It is better if we have a few packets. So then in that case, if there is only one or few packets, then datagram delivery will be quicker. Another advantage of datagram is that it is more flexible. So suppose if there is a congestion or traffic on one of the routes, then the packets can be routed away from the congestion. But in the case of this congestion, in the case of virtual circuits, what will happen is that packets need to follow the pre-planned route, and it is more difficult for a network to move away from the congestion. And another advantage is datagram is more reliable. Let me just mention it over here. Datagram is more reliable, and with the use of virtual circuits, if a single node fails, then all the virtual circuits that pass through that node are lost. With datagram delivery, if a node fails, the other packets may find an alternate route and they will not use that node. So a datagram style of operation, that is the datagram circuit, is a datagram approach, is most commonly used in our internetworks. That is, in the internet, what we use is the datagram approach, which is the connection-less approach. Virtual circuit is the connection-oriented approach. So now you will understand why we are calling them the connection-less and the connection-oriented approach. So this datagram, once again, let me just mention it here, is the connection-less approach. And virtual circuit is the connection-oriented approach. Also, we have to know this one another term, which is the packet loss. Basically, packets will be bouncing from node to node before reaching the destination IP address. So sometimes what will happen is that these kind of lost data packets in the network can congest the network, leading to poor performance. So the data packets which are bouncing too many times, that is, they are traveling from one node to another multiple times, they may get lost. So to help with this problem, what will happen is that we set a number of maximum number of hop or bounce. That is, if a data packet travels from a node to another node 6 times or 10 times, then the data packets must be discarded. So in that case, what will happen is that the router or the node will delete it. So this will basically result in the decongestion of the network. And we have also seen the advantages of packet switching over circuit switching. So just write it, let's write it once again. So the main advantage is the efficiency. That is, improved efficiency is leading to a less network bandwidth wastage. Then the second is the speed. So it will increase the transmission speed in the case of packet switching. And we have improved fault tolerance. So if suppose in the case of circuit switching network, we have seen if a single node is a loss, if the single node is not working or it has switched off, then in that case, that complete circuit will be complete circuit will lead to failure of the packets being reached. So in the case of packet switching, we have already seen if a single node is not working, then the packets will be rerouted. And even with respect to the budget or the cost, it is cost efficient. Packet switching is cost efficient because it is basically based on the duration of connectivity, whereas circuit switching is based on both the connection and the distance. Then for digital, that is for the data transmission, we always prefer packet switching. Data transmissions are generally high quality in a packet switched network. And these are the advantages of packet switching over circuit switching. So why is packet switching better? Now we will see why is circuit switching better. Why circuit switching is better. So this is just for keeping in mind, it is not actually, we will actually see a comparison between all of this with respect to the textbook, but here this is just to answer the questions or to understand the topic better. Now this is why is circuit switching better when compared to packet switching. So first is in the case of reliability. In the case of circuit switched networks, the packets are delivered in order along the same route. That is why we have seen already the reliability part. Then next is the complexity. Packet switching protocols are complex and they require a large amount of RAM. And then we have the file size. Packet switching is better for messages, small messages, while circuit switching is usually good for larger transmissions. So this is with respect to the packet switching versus circuit switching. And we will see one more topic, which is the packet size. Now, whenever we are talking about the packet size and also the transmission time, there is a relationship between the packet size and transmission time. Now, what is that relationship? We will see by using this diagram. So first and foremost, in this example, we are talking about a virtual circuit, which is from station X through nodes. So let me just zoom in over here. Yeah, so we are talking about sending data from station X to station Y. In between, we are using the nodes A and B. Now, the message to be sent is comprising of, the size of the data is basically 40 octets or 40 bytes. And each packet contains 3 bytes of control information also, that is the header. So what will happen, which is placed, the header is at the beginning of the packet, and if the entire message is sent as a single packet of 43, that is 43 bytes, then the packet is first transmitted from station X to node A. So here, if you notice, first we have, this is the station X, it is going to node A, then node B, and then it will reach the station Y. Now, ignoring that switching time, whatever it is taking to switch from one node to another, what is the total time which is being taken? It is 43 into 3. Why? Because we are transmitting it three times, once, twice, and thrice. So from X to A, A to B, and then B to Y. Now, suppose if we are breaking the message into two packets, each containing 20 bytes of data, then what will happen? 20 bytes, again, then we have to add the header, which is of 3 bytes. So in that case, what will happen is we are sending the data with respect to 40, in this case, 26, which is, 26, 20 bytes of data plus 3 bytes of header, so 23, and then 23. It is taking 46, and the total data which is being sent is 46, and the transmission time will be 46 into how many times we are transferring. So here, first, this will be transferred. Here, we are transferring once, 43 again twice, then thrice. Over here, if you notice, 23 is first transferred, and already this is transferred over here. Then again, 23 transferred. So basically, if you calculate, it will take 92 times. So the transmission rate is 92 times. Now, if we are breaking the message into 5 packets, then the transmission is even faster and the saving time is greater. That is, it is only taking 77 times, or you can say it is unit of time that we are calculating for the transmission. However, if we even more decrease the packet, that is, if we are making 10 packets, then in this case, the transmission time is not decreasing, but it is increasing. Okay, so in the last figure, if you notice, the transmission time has increased actually. So because here, in the case if we are having 10 packets, means we have 10 headers also. So 10 headers with 3 bytes means it is of 30 bytes. Already 40 bytes of data and then 30 bytes of header. So the transmission time has increased exponentially. If we increase the packet size, then the transmission time at some particular instance will be low. But after that, the transmission time will increase because the amount of headers will also increase. So this shows that the example, it shows that the processing and the queuing delays at each node will increase also, because if we have multiple packets, that means that each node, there will be a line or a queue. So in that case, we will see that the delays are also greater after some extent. So this is a disadvantage of the packet size if we are increasing the number of packets by after some interval, or basically if you're increasing the packets by 2 or 5, you see that the time has decreased. But if you're increasing the packets with 10 packets or 20 packets, then the transmission time will increase. So I hope you have got the point over here. Now next we will be seeing the disadvantages in the same way, the circuit versus packet switching. The first is the propagation delay. Then we have the transmission time. So the time, a single comparison is basically the time which is taken for circuit switching is, it takes the transmitter to send a block of data. For example, if it takes 1 second to transmit 10,000 bit block of data on the line, and also the node delay, that is whatever is the time it takes for a node to perform the necessary processing. Basically, whenever we are talking about node delay, it is the switching delay. That is, whenever it takes time to process on the node, which node to be sent next, what is the destination address, all those things to be processed. So that is the node delay. So with this, we will be seeing the comparison of all the three switching techniques in the next class, and we will be seeing the different logical addressing format. So I'll be concluding the class today. Thank you.